This
things, you know, they
conference will now be recorded.
overlapping features of either ulcerate of both ulcerative colitis and Crohn's disease. One thing you have to remember is this IBD itself is a lifelong disease. It is a chronic inflammatory condition. Coming to this ulcerative colitis, as you can see over it, the definition it says that it is a chronic inflammatory condition and it is a mucosal inflammation. When you compare this to Crohn's disease, it is a transmural inflammation, and ulcerative colitis is mostly mucosal and submucosal inflammation. Okay, there is a rectal involvement and varying degrees of colonic involvement. Whereas in Crohn's disease, there is in Crohn's disease also there can be rectal involvement. A few textbooks say rectal is actually spared in Crohn's disease, which is actually a misconception. Rectum can be affected even in Crohn's disease up to 20 to 25% of the cases, especially when colonic involvement is there. Rectal involvement will almost invariably be there in Crohn's disease. But in ulcerative colitis, rectal involvement is the dictum. The disease basically it starts in the rectum and involves colon up to various levels. Okay, these three words which have been highlighted, they have to be remembered. It is a continuous, confluent and concentric involvement of the bowel, of the large bowel. Okay, so continuous, it means there is no skip lesions. It involves continuously right from the rectum. It proceeds proximally to sigmoid, descending, transverse, ascending and cecum. Confluent and concentric, that is for complete circumferential, and it has typically a relapsing and a remitting course. As I said before, 10 to 15% of them will be indeterminate colitis, that is, they will have features of both ulcerative and Crohn's, and it has to be treated separately. Okay, and there are two peaks in age distribution. One is in the late adolescence and early adulthood stage, which is in the early 20s, 20s and 20s and 30s, and the second peak it occurs after 50 years, and there is equal sex distribution. Basically, my PPTs will all be brief, and it mostly covers the management part and how to evaluate, how to manage each and everything. Because the rest of the things you can read in the textbooks, and it is the common in everything. Okay, so coming to the classification of this, how do you classify ulcerative colitis? You know, various classifications are there based on severity, based on involvement, and all these things. Okay. First and most important classification is the segment involved. Okay, based on that, as you can see it, proctitis, left-sided colitis, pancolitis with backwash ileitis. Basically, what is the importance of classification based on segments? See, as you know, ulcerative colitis can turn into malignancy over a long term, and it has to have a separate screening protocol, and treatment differs based on the classification. I'll tell you why. Because proctitis, it means only involvement of the rectum. The entire colon is not involved. So that has a different management. Most of the proctitis patients, ulcerative colitis, which involves only the rectum, that is proctitis, can be managed either with mesocol enema or mesocol suppositories. Okay, you don't need systemic steroids, you don't need a screening protocol for all these patients. Okay, left-sided colitis, it means it affects only the rectum and the left side of the colon, that is sigmoid and part of descending colon. Pancolitis, it involves the entire colon, and pancolitis with backwash ileitis, which can be seen in up to 10 to 15% of the patients, even the terminal ileum is involved. So what is the importance of this classification? As I said, screening for malignancy in cases of ulcerative colitis. Proctitis, left-sided colitis will not have any significant screening protocols. Whereas pancolitis and pancolitis with backwash ileitis, if there is acute severe or acute fulminant episode, these patients are more prone for complication, more prone for hospital admissions, IV steroids, and also biologics like tacrolimus, infliximabs, and also more prone for surgeries. And also, even if they are managed medically, you have to keep them on a screening protocol for screening for cancer of the colorectal malignancies. They have a separate screening protocols. based on the severity, based on the involvement, they may have up to so ileocolonoscopy once in every 3 years. Whereas the proctitis and left-sided colitis will not have such a severe or stringent screening protocol. Coming to the diagnosis, how do they present? Clinically, they usually present first initially with increased frequency of stools. As the severity increases, the frequency increases, and the bleeding per rectum happens. The more involvement of the rectum, the more severity of the ulcerative colitis and the rectal involvement, the more will be the tenesmus, the urgency, all these things. In severe acute severe ulcerative colitis cases, they may have pain abdomen, distension of abdomen, and fever. Okay, apart from this, the most important is the clinical examination. Abdominal examination, you have to rule out signs of peritonitis, because that is the one of the indication for emergency surgery in ulcerative colitis. Okay, then when you suspect something like ulcerative colitis, you definitely have to do a sigmoidoscopy / colonoscopy, and the most important is, first we have to look for the endoscopic findings, wherein, you know, early you will have some amount of mucosal edema, loss of vascular pattern, nodularity. When it is severe, you know, you will have this erythema, friability, and the mucosa bleeds on even on the touch, or spontaneous bleeds based on the severity of the cases. Okay, definitely it has to be, the endoscopy has to be supported by a histopathology, because the most important differential diagnosis for ulcerative colitis you have to rule out is CMV colitis and Clostridium difficile colitis. Okay, because the treatment is completely opposite. In ulcerative colitis, you give anti-inflammatory like steroids, you decrease the inflammation. Whereas in the other thing, that is the CMV colitis as well as Clostridium difficile infection, you have to add antivirals and antibiotics based on the diagnosis. So the treatment is completely opposite. You have to be sure that there is no Clostridium difficile or CMV infection. Previously, this was not there, but according to the latest ECO guidelines, ECCO, European Crohn's and Colitis Organization guidelines, okay, these are now mandatory to do. Okay, so what do you do? What do you find in biopsy? You know, you find this characteristic initial finding will be the basal plasmacytosis, and later on you will see various levels of crypt architecture distortion, cryptitis, crypt abscess, and acute inflammatory cell infiltrates in all the in the layers of mucosa and submucosa of the colon. Okay, that is the characteristic findings. There will not be any evidence of granulomas. Okay. And imaging in ulcerative colitis, you know, it is basically to rule out complications. That is one of the most important complications are toxic megacolon and peritonitis due to hollow viscous perforation. Okay. Toxic megacolon, they say that any segment of the large bowel, which is of the diameter more than 5.5 centimeter, few standard references also say it is more than 6 centimeter. But according to the latest ECO guidelines, they have given anything more than 5.5 centimeter and persistent can be labeled as toxic megacolon. Okay, and you have to have a look at the pneumoperitoneum. If it is there, then there is no role of medical management. You have to take the patient immediately for surgery. The other imaging, if on plain X-ray erect abdomen, if these both are not there, the next most important is either the CECT abdomen or MR enterography. Okay, why MR enterography is done in a particular subset of patients? Most of the time it is CECT abdomen because it is easily available and it can be read even by a general surgeon. Okay, CECT abdomen shows large bowel wall thickening, the distension, the edema, the pericolonic edema, fat stranding, and all these things. You know, it shows the extent of involvement of the colon. Okay, the mucosa, upon giving the contrast, the mucosa will enhance. So that means there is active inflammation. Okay, in patients where CT is contraindicated. For example, they have allergic reaction or any reaction to contrast when the serum creatinine is high, then role of MR enterography. Role of MR enterography in inflammatory bowel disease, apart from this ulcerative colitis, normally in inflammatory bowel disease, especially in Crohn's patients. Because Crohn's is a lifelong disease and it has to be managed only medically. Only in cases of complication, the role of surgery, and that too, it is a very limited role for surgery in Crohn's disease. That is only segmental resection. There is no extensive resections in Crohn's disease because that may lead to short bowel syndrome in the future. So, Crohn's disease patients will have frequent follow-ups and frequent evaluations. In those patients, especially those young patients, instead of subjecting to repeated radiation, MR enterography has a significant role in those patients, especially Crohn's disease patient. Okay, so that is the role of MR enterography according to the latest radiological as well as the echo guidelines. So other possible differential diagnosis, as I said, CMV colitis, Clostridium difficile colitis, vascular ischemic colitis, and all these things. You have to differentiate with all these things. And basic labs, the CBP, wherein because you have to see the hemoglobin because there is bleeding per rectum and bloody stools, significant drop of HbE is expected, and you need to have blood transfusions. One of the most important criteria to label it as acute severe or acute fulminant colitis is your hemoglobin levels. Then TLC levels to look for the counts and also the platelet levels. Remember, ulcerative colitis, acute severe ulcerative colitis or IBD itself is a procoagulant state. So there is chances of deep venous thrombosis. Remember this, because any patient of acute severe colitis, apart from hydration, you need to add what do you call this thromboprophylaxis. Okay. Next, RFT. Because of increased frequency and bloody diarrhea, all these things, patients tend to be dehydrated and they go into pre-renal AKI. So you have to look, and also you have to check for the electrolytes. Because of the increased frequency of stools, you will have electrolyte imbalance. Patient may go into metabolic acidosis. You will have decreased sodium levels, decreased potassium levels, decreased calcium levels. All these may lead to colonic hypomotility and the distension of the colon, which will predispose to toxic megacolon. Okay, so you need to have a baseline RFT, you need to correct them as soon as possible. Okay, next, standard LFT, because few patients of ulcerative colitis can have associated PSC. Associated PSC patients initially present with ulcerative acute severe colitis very, very rarely. So you need to have a baseline LFT. CRP, ESR are used for grading of severity. Okay. Raised CRP, raised ESR, they have this in the severity scoring, they will be labeled, the score increases and they'll be labeled as acute severe ulcerative colitis. Next, fecal calprotectin. Any patient with inflammatory bowel disease, this is a very important marker. Okay, fecal calprotectin, because this shows the severity of the inflammation, mucosal inflammation in the colon. This shows the severity at present, and on follow-up, it shows the maintenance of the episode, and if and for any relapse, it is one of the early markers for relapse. So you can predict relapse based on the fecal calprotectin levels. Okay. Apart from this, one more lab investigation which I forgot to mention here is a TPMT. TPMT enzyme assay. If you are using azathioprine, okay, thiopurine methyltransferase enzyme. If you have a plan to use azathioprine in the future, then you have to have this enzyme assay, TPMT enzyme assay, because more than the required around 5 to 10% of the patients, they may have genetically decreased TPMT enzyme levels in them. If you are giving azathioprine, then it can lead to dangerous permanent leukopenia and further lymphoma complications. Irreversible bone marrow suppression can also happen. So azathioprine has to be used only after TPMT enzyme assay. okay, without that it is advisable not to start as a diopterin. Okay, and as I said, CMV biopsy for CMV, CMV PCR and Clostridium def stool for Clostridium difficile toxins. Coming to the severity, this basically it comes in acute severe colitis. There are three different criteria which are actually standardized, but TrueLove and WITS criteria, it's one of the old, one of the easiest, because it is completely based on clinical clinical examination and few easily available lab parameters. Blood stools per day more than 6 per day, pulse rate, tachycardia more than 90, temperature going up, any drop in hemoglobin less than 9, raised ESR, raised ERCP. Based on that, acute severe colitis is differentiated into 3 stages. Why this severity is important to mark at the earliest presentation of the patient? Because on any patient of acute severe colitis, first line of management is medical management. Okay, after 2 to 3 days of medical initial medical management, you are going to again reassess the patient, the improvement. So based on this severity scoring, you are going to reassess the patient. And remember, TrueLove and WITS criteria is a very easily available, easily done bedside criteria. Okay, you can triage the patient whether he is improving, whether he is stagnant, or whether he is deteriorating in spite of the medical management. Okay, that's why even now many centers follow TrueLove and WITS criteria. Many gastroenterology centers which are dealing with acute ulcerative colitis patients, they follow TrueLove and WITS criteria. Other important criteria are Mayo criteria also, which shows which takes into account the frequency of stools, bleeding per rectum, mucosal appearance based on the endoscopic assessment, and the physician global assessment, that is the overall look and general assessment of the patient. So this is slightly dependent on the physician as well as the endoscopic appearance. So that is why this has a lesser importance when compared to TrueLove and WITS criteria, but this is also standardized criteria. And another criteria for assessing the severity is the endoscopic criteria, which is generally done by the medical gastroenterologist. Okay, as I said, the main motto of the management of this thing, ulcerative colitis, is to subside the acute episode, to maintain the remission, and to prevent the relapse. Remember, the aim of the medical management of ulcerative colitis is 3 things. First, to reduce the acute episode. Second, to maintain the remission. That means after control of the acute episode, you are maintaining the remission. Third thing, to prevent a relapse. Okay, this is the main aim of the medical management. Now, what are the things we have at our discretion for medical management? You have this mesalamine, this 5-ASA compounds, you have the steroids, you have the thiopurine, azathioprine, which I mentioned previously, you have the cyclosporine, and other latest biologics, that is TNF-alpha, anti-TNF-alpha, there's infliximab, adalimumab, and golimumab. The table which you can see about inflammatory bowel induction of a clinical remission and the maintenance of clinical remission. Okay. The criteria for a complete healing, the complete remission, is clinical. That means patient will not have any diarrhea, no bleeding per rectum, no fever, no anemia, fecal calprotectin normal, on endoscopy mucosal healing. That means whatever the changes were there during the episode of acute episode of ulcerative colitis, now it has been maintained because of the medical management. I mean, the mucosa should be near normal. Okay, based on the treatment, medical treatment and endoscopic appearance, patient will now be labeled either he is completely in remission, if he is a long-term remitter, or a short-term with frequent relapses and infrequent relapses, because even this will change the plan of medical management. Okay, the basis of medical management in a patient with ulcerative colitis is 5-ASA or mesalamine components. Okay, what are these? Basically, these are anti-inflammatory components which are basically for the colonic inflammation. Okay, they have a very limited, very minimal actually, small bubble release. So the entire component will be, entire component of the drug will be released in the colon. So these work excellently for colonic inflammations, ulcerative colitis. Whereas these have very limited mesalamine 5-ASA components have very minimal role in Crohn's disease. Azathioprine, mesalamine components have been used for induction, I mean treatment of acute ulcerative acute colitis in acute proctitis, acute left-sided colitis, and mild pan colitis. Okay, mild to moderate ulcerative colitis, and for remission also they are actually successful. Steroids, when the mesalamine is not able to control it properly, then we will have to go for steroids. That means, see, for example, if you see a proctitis patient can be divided into either mild or moderate, and most of the proctitis mild to moderate patient can be managed with either mesalamine suppositories or enemas. And if it is severe, then you can add systemic mesalamine or systemic oral corticosteroids if required. Okay, that is the management of proctitis. So most important component of proctitis management is mesalamine. Okay, role of steroids come only if it is severe proctitis and if it is bleeding. Apart from topical, that is mesalamine enemas or mesocal enemas and suppositories, you may add oral steroids. Okay, in this steroids also conventionally prednisolone was used, but prednisolone has much severe side effects. So now latest budesonide is also being used apart from prednisolone because it has a better efficacy profile, safety efficacy. Okay, left-sided ulcerative colitis, again mild to moderate cases of mesalamine enema and suppositories are the main treatment along with oral mesalamine. In severe moderate to severe cases of left-sided ulcerative colitis, okay, you will have mesalamine components, oral plus topical, and plus role of oral steroid, that is tapering dose. Always, always, always steroids have to be given on a tapering dose, and this tapering dose should go on up to 6 to 8 weeks or 3 months based on the initial dose that you are given, okay, and the severity of the ulcerative colitis. Okay, these are for oral steroids. So now management of proctitis is over, management of left-sided ulcerative colitis is over. Now pancolitis. Even in pancolitis, mild to moderate cases, you can deal them with either mesalamine, that is enemas, oral mesalamine, and either enema or combination with oral. There is no role for suppositories in pancolitis. Okay, very limited role. Especially if the rectal involvement is more, then only there is role for suppository. Or else, enemas generally it goes up to the splenic flexure and distal transverse colon. So they are very effective in controlling left-sided colitis and pancolitis, and with systemic mesalamine, that is oral tablets and oral steroids. This is for mild to moderate ulcerative colitis, and systemic oral steroids which you are giving, they have to be tapered. If you're giving prednisolone, generally we give it at about 30 to 40 mg initially, then we for 2 weeks we give the dose, then every 2 weeks we reduce it by 5 mg. So overall it comes to around 3 months treatment, 2 to 3 months treatment, based on the initial, based on the response patient is giving and based on the tapering levels. Okay, because these have to be also seen from a side effect profile also. So we generally tapering is done 5 mg every 2 weeks. Ultimately, last 2 weeks patient should take 5 mg, then we have to stop it. They should not be stopped abruptly at any given point of time. Okay. Next, in moderate to severe ulcerative pancolitis. So now we have dealt with proctitis and left-sided ulcerative colitis and mild to moderate pancolitis. Now comes severe, moderate to severe pancolitis, wherein you have to admit this is the basic gist of the medical treatment for ulcerative colitis in mild, moderate, and severe cases. In severe cases, there is no other option. You have to admit the patient, and previous labs, whatever I said, have to be sent. Resuscitation have to be start immediately with IV fluids, blood transfusion depending on the hemoglobin levels, and as I said previously, thromboprophylaxis. Okay, you have to, because this is a very dangerous procoagulant state. When patient can land up with deep vein thrombosis and pulmonary embolism because of the inflammatory bowel disease as such, as well as because of the dehydration component. So now we will deal only with acute severe colitis for some time, because we have already discussed previously the other things. The patient generally presents with bloody diarrhea, dehydration, anemia, tachycardia, temperature, abdomen distension, electrolyte imbalance, and signs of peritonitis if there is any perforation or gangrene. What is the algorithm for management of acute severe ulcerative colitis? First, you have to hospitalize him, resuscitate with IV fluids, IV antibiotics, blood transfusion, and all these things, intensive medical therapy, which I will tell you, and next, either second line medical therapy or surgery. I'll tell you what to choose between them in the coming slide. What is intensive medical management? The basis of treatment for acute severe ulcerative colitis is IV steroids, either IV methylprednisolone or hydrocortisone. Methylprednisolone 60 mg IV OD or hydrocortisone 100 mg IV 4 times a day. This is the basis of treatment of medical management of acute severe ulcerative colitis, apart from other supportive care, that is fluids, antibiotics, blood transfusion, thromboprophylaxis. Because you are giving steroids, you have to give them PPIs, all these things, temperature monitoring, vitals monitoring. Most important is abdominal girth measurement. Okay, this is clinical, generally one of the most neglected thing, but clinically bedside, not only this case, any post-operative patient or any patient you are suspecting for peritonitis, obstruction, and all these things, always remember simple abdominal girth measurement at the level of umbilicus consistently by one examiner, because you tend to change the position of the tape and all these things. So consistently at one point, the abdominal girth measurement is a very important factor to determine the prognosis of the patient. Okay, so after starting this medical management, you have to reevaluate daily to look for signs of peritonitis and deterioration. Any signs of deterioration, any signs of peritonitis, any X-ray showing pneumoperitoneum, you have to take them immediately for surgery. Okay, if there is no peritonitis, no pneumoperitoneum, then the standard is reassess on the third day of treatment. Okay, what are you going to reassess? The same thing here, number of stools associated with blood, pulse rate, hemoglobin, ESR. Okay, these are the things which come under Trulove and Witt's criteria. Those are the things you have to reassess. If the patient is not improving or patient is going down, then if patient first will see about patient improving. If the patient is improving, then if all the criteria of Trulove and Witt's criteria, all the weights are improving, that means stool frequency has decreased, bleeding has decreased, pulse rate is normal, temperature, no fever spikes, no decrease in hemoglobin, ESR is improving, then medical treatment will continue. Even in IV steroids, you have to taper the IV, overlap it with oral corticosteroids, then stop IV steroids, and oral steroids you have to taper over 3 to 6 months. So this is the standard tapering schedule for steroids. Okay, if the patient is not improving or if the patient is deteriorating, then there are two things: either second line of medical management, second line of intensive medical management versus surgery. Okay, generally in our Indian setup, we generally tend to take the patient directly for surgery, but you have to learn, you have to know what is the second line of medical management. It involves either IV cyclosporine or infliximabs. Okay, the second line of medical intensive medical management for patients who are not responding to IV steroids is either cyclosporine or infliximabs. Okay, generally even after starting this, again you have to reevaluate daily and reassess after 3 days. If patient is not improving, then the ultimate option is surgery. Okay, even the same criteria for evaluation, reassessment, everything is the same. But apart from steroids, you are giving cyclosporine or infliximab. But if the patient deteriorates and if you have to take up for surgery, generally the complication rate is high, because by the time you take up for surgery, that is 6 to 7 days after giving even the second line of medical management, the complication patient will be sick, wound complications are high, surgical complications are high, bowel inside will not be good, so there are chances of intra-abdominal infections, abscesses, collections. So the post-operative period will be stormy when compared to taking up for surgery immediately after the first line of medical management. I hope you understand the difference between the intensive medical management first step and the second line. Okay, in India, generally because of the cost factors and because of the available medical resources, we generally tend to take, I generally prefer surgery immediately after the failure of first line of medical management. There are some people who still want to try for medicines as long as possible, but that is up to them. Giving them the option of surgery is our responsibility. So you have to remember that there is a first line medical management, the second line medical management, and then surgery. You can even bypass from first line medical management. If patient is not improving, you can counsel them and take them up for surgery. Okay, both are accepted, and according to the latest ECHO guidelines, which are the standard guidelines for inflammatory bowel disease, both ulcerative colitis and Crohn's, surgery can be taken even after first line of medical management if the patient is not improving. Okay, that depends on the treating doctors and the patients. So what is actually surgery in ulcerative colitis? What are the indications? In emergency, first we'll talk about emergency indications. Emergency indications, acute severe colitis or acute fulminant colitis, which are not getting treated with medical management, either first line or second line, whatever, patient is not improving, then yes, you have to take up for surgery. Toxic megacolon, as I said previously, even after resuscitation, electrolyte correction, and all these things, which serial x-ray shows any segment of the colon more than 6 centimeters, it is a toxic megacolon, and that has to be taken for surgery, because the chances of improvement are very low, and the more the delay, the more the chances of patient landing into complications such as gangrene, perforation, peritonitis, where when you take up for surgery such patients, the complication rate will obviously be higher, the morbidity and mortality rates. Okay, next, around 5 to 10% of the patient, they have intractable bleeding per rectum, which cannot be controlled with simple blood transfusion and endoscopic methods, wherein you have to take up for surgery. Very rarely you have perforation, and in very rare case scenarios you may have obstruction because of the edema inside the lumen. Okay, these are the standard emergency indications for surgery in acute in ulcerative colitis. Whereas coming to the elective indications, you have to remember few terminologies. Okay, intractable disease or presence of cancer or dysplasia in the background of ulcerative colitis. What is intractable disease? Even after lung failure to respond to medical treatment, okay, or what do you call the steroid dependent or steroid resistant? Steroid dependent means he is continuously on steroids and you are not able to taper, because once you taper from steroids, he is again developing ulcerative colitis. Those are steroid dependent. Steroid refractory, even after giving oral or IV steroids, it is difficult to manage them with only medical management. Okay, those are intractable disease. You have criteria for them. I mean, that is not so important for you. Steroid dependent, more than 20 mg oral steroids for more than 3 months, that is one of the criteria to say it as steroid dependent. Okay, next thing is complications of medical therapy because of either long-term use of steroids or azathioprine or infliximabs, if long-term usage can cause complications. Because of the complication, you are not able to give them further. In those patients, you need to consider surgery. Persistent anemias, undernourishment, and protein losing enteropathy because of recurrent acute episodes, recurrent acute exacerbations or relapses, then you have to consider for surgery. Growth failure in pediatric patients, because especially you need to keep them on long-term medical management. In such patients, you may consider surgery early in the course of the disease and some severe intractable extraintestinal manifestations. Remember, PSC and PSC and ankylosing spondylitis do not go hand in hand with severity of ulcerative colitis, whereas the remaining things, they go hand in hand. As when you give medical treatment, when the acute ulcerative colitis subside, those extraintestinal manifestations subside. When you do surgery for them, those extraintestinal manifestations will be under control, except PSC and ankylosing spondylitis. Okay, these two have an independent course, and the presence of them predicts a very severe ulcerative colitis. Presence of PSC is more chances of turning into malignancies. Okay, more chance of turning into malignancies for in the background of ulcerative colitis. Now, special mention of cancer or dysplasia associated lesions in these things. Ulcerative colitis, lungs, basically ulcerative colitis itself, you can consider it as a pre-malignant condition. Longer the duration of ulcerative colitis, more involvement of the colon, and more the severe episode, more is the risk for cancers. Okay, so proctitis, left-sided ulcerative colitis have a very, 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 very low incidence of colorectal malignancies. But pancolitis with acute severe episodes, early age of onset of ulcerative colitis, you will have more incidence of malignancies. So screening is important in them. That is the basis of categorization of severity based on the location. Okay, they may either present any lesion which is abnormal upon screening ileocolonoscopy. Ideally, it should be an ileocolonoscopy. It should not be a simple colonoscopy. That means even terminal ileum intubation. Always remember, any patient you are suspecting of inflammatory bowel disease or a TB abdomen, anything, you need to mention it as ileocolonoscopy. You have to see the terminal 10 to 15 centimeters of the ileum in all cases. Okay, remember that, because you need to evaluate few more things. If there is any lesion, skip lesions, all these things. If there is any associated tuberculosis, so all these things have to be evaluated. Now comes the most important thing, that is associated dysplastic lesions or polyps. Generally, there will be pseudopolyps developing, and you need to snare them and you need to do them biopsy. Now, dysplastic lesions, you have two things: either they are flat or sessile, or they are pedunculated. If they are pedunculated, you have to pedunculate, remove it, send it for biopsy. If it is high grade dysplasia, you have to consider for surgery after explaining. If it is flat lesion, generally you have to do a biopsy. If it is high grade dysplasia, then you have to go for surgery. Okay, and any part of colon involvement proximal to the ulcerative colitis, I mean, if it is left sided colitis and you find polyps in the ascending colon, cecum, or proximal transverse colon, then they have to be dealt separately. They do not come under the spectrum of ulcerative colitis. Okay, so any high grade lesion, any malignancy, or any high low grade lesion like sessile things and flat lesions which are not able to be removed completely on colonoscopy, you have to consider surgery in such patients. Okay, next comes this fulminant colitis. As I have explained previously, these are the indications for emergency surgery: fulminant colitis, toxic megacolon, 6 centimeter dilatation, massive hemorrhage which occurs in up to 10 to approximately 10%, and very perforation. Surgical options. You have to remember four important surgeries in patients with ulcerative colitis. Okay, standard was total proctocolectomy. Remember the terms, the terminology is important. Total proctocolectomy, that means total removal of the colon and the rectum up to the pelvic floor. Okay, total proctocolectomy with end ileostomy. This was the surgery which was done previously. Okay, once upon a time in the old age, like now, because modern stoma bags have come, previously they were not available. So what they used to do is the last thing, that is the total proctocolectomy with Cox continent ileostomy. wherein they create an artificial valve before the ileostomy, but the chances of complications of this valve and all these things are high. So now no one is considering, according to my knowledge, no one is doing this continent ileostomy, because now we have good knowledge about stomas, how to manage them, latest stoma bags and all these things. So previously that stoma bags were not available, so patient need continent even for the ileostomy. So whenever they feel that the pouch, the stoma pouch is filling, they used to go it and evacuate. So now, because now that is not a problem, we have very nice stoma bag equipment, so no one is considering continent Cox ileostomy. The second most common surgery done is restorative proctocolectomy. That means after doing total proctocolectomy, you have to restore with ileal pouch anal anastomosis, IPAA. Remember, this pouch can be three types, either J, W, and S. I will tell you when to do and what are the differences between them. Okay, so after total proctocolectomy, we are restoring the intestinal continuity with an ileal pouch anal anastomosis. Okay, the terminology is important. Next, total colectomy with ileorectal anastomosis. This means you are removing the entire colon and you are taking the ileum and anastomosing it to the rectum. When do you consider this? What are the indications for different surgeries? I'll tell you. You can see the choice of operation. Now they have considering even this rectal mucosectomy, wherein there is acute like dysplastic dysplasia, and you remove the rectal mucosa per anally and you do the anastomosis, but the complication rates are high after this mucosectomy. I'll explain you that. So normally the lower four things are done, which is this stapled pouch anastomosis, okay, continent ileostomy, normal Brooks ileostomy, and ileorectal anastomosis. Any patient, you can see this, the such images. Now total proctocolectomy with permanent ileostomy, when do you consider this? Okay, patients who are having significant comorbidities, patient who are having rectal malignancies, wherein you have to remove the entire rectum and probably you need to do an APR. Patients who are having poor sphincter tones. Age is not a criteria for doing a pouch. Generally, we avoid it in an elderly age, but age as such is not a criteria for doing a pouch. So comorbidities, high risk patients, poor sphincter functions, underlying malignancy beneath the, especially in the lower rectum, we consider total proctocolectomy with a permanent ileostomy. Okay, generally in young patients, young females, also we tend to give them the option of ileostomy. Why? Because if you do a pouch, resurgeries in the pelvis and all these things because of the pelvic complications, pouchitis and all these things, they tend to have higher rates of infertility because of pelvic adhesions. Because of the pelvic adhesions, the entire fimbriae and ostiae are closed and they tend to be infertile. So for them also, we can consider a permanent ileostomy. As I said, managing at in the present age, managing a stoma is very easy, not like before. Next, image B, Cox continent ileostomy. As you can see now, no one is doing, so I don't, it is of just of a historical interest, I guess. Next is a pouch anastomosis C, wherein the distal, see, always remember this total proctocolectomy, whatever you are doing, it is theoretical total proctocolectomy. You will have 1 to 2 centimeters, not more than 2 centimeters. If you are doing a staple, you will have 1 to 2 centimeters of the rectum that will be remaining. Generally, if you are doing hands-on, probably around 2 centimeters. If you are doing a stapler, probably around 1 centimeter of the rectal cuff will be remaining above the dentate line. Okay, so that is a normal stapled anastomosis. As you can see here, this is a J pouch. This is the small bubble. The J pouch is creating. Each limb will be 15 centimeters. The pouch capacity approximately should be 250 to 300 centimeters, which will replace the normal rectal capacity. Okay, this is the stapled line of the anastomosis. Generally, this is a double stapled technique. I mean, the pouch, normally you transect it here, and from below, circular stapler will go and create a pouch anal anastomosis. We'll it as anal lesion, but there will be 1 centimeter of rectum remaining. It should not be more than 2 centimeters. Okay. Now comes the this thing of mucosectomy, rectal mucosectomy. In patients who have significant proctitis, or in patients where you find mild dysplasia and all these things, people what they tend to do, they tend to remove the rectal mucosa and anastomose. Okay. Removing this rectal mucosa will lead to slight increase in pelvic complications. That means you'll have this intramural abscess formation, cuffitis, pelvic sepsis, and all these things. Okay, that is considered in a very minority of patients. And few patients you do Hansoon coloanal anastomosis. Apart from, you don't use staplers, you use Hansoon. The difference between stapler and Hansoon time is ease of anastomosis with the stapler rather than Hansoon. With Hansoon, there is more chance, because you stretch the anal canal, the more chance of sphincter laxity and loss of continence in future. So right now, as of now, stapled, double stapled anastomosis is the standard IPAA technique. Okay. Then last thing is the abdominal total colectomy with ileorectal anastomosis. You know, patients who don't want pelvic dissection and mild rectal disease, who are willing for long-term surveillance and all these things, they tend to spare the rectum. They tend to spare the rectum, but always they are at a risk for future recurrence of relapse of ulcerative colitis. The thing is, you can manage them medically with either suppositories or enema, because as I said, proctitis can be managed effectively with topical mesalamine, that is either suppositories or enemas. But the only problem comes when now this turns into malignancy. If it turns into malignancy, you don't have any other option. You have to remove the complete thing and you have to come up and do a endostoma. So you have to warn the patient before doing ileorectal anastomosis. Very selective patients you do in ulcerative colitis. And also few cases of indeterminate colitis where you don't find features adequately of either ulcerative colitis or Crohn's, you may consider this ileorectal anastomosis. So I guess I'm clear about what are the different types of surgical options and the indications of doing this. Okay. A brief overview: proctocolectomy with end ileostomy. This is a gold standard procedure for comparison because this has the least complication rates. I'll tell you why least complication rate. Indications: impaired sphincter function, significant comorbidities, and patient preference. Young patients who want to have future fertility, who don't want future infertility issues and all these things. Morbidity: few stoma related complication. Others with small bowel obstructions. Mild alteration in bladder and sexual function because of the excessive pelvic dissections, infertility, and a restorative proctocolectomy, most common procedure done in the elective setting. Okay, the approach is either open or laparoscopic approach, both are equally good. It is either a two stage or three stage. Very, very few centers do a single stage surgery, but I have never done a single stage surgery. Always ulcerative colitis has to be a two stage or three stage. What are these two and three stages? I'll tell you. Most commonly used configuration is a J configuration because it is easy to construct a J configuration pouch. It is easy to manage with the least complication rate, because the more the pouch complexity, that is either the WRS, the more the anastomosis, the more the chances of leak, and more difficult to manage. But there is no difference in the capacity, because ultimately J pouch will initially have around 8 to 10 or 8 to 12 loose stools. Ultimately the capacity will increase and it will come down. Normal pouch evacuation is 4 to 6 stools per day with one nocturnal evacuation is a normal evacuation in a pouch patient. Okay, you remember that. Any patient you do pouch, patient come with 4 times 5 times stools, yes, it is perfectly normal. Anastomotic technique is double staple technique, mucosectomy with Hansoon anastomosis, as I explained previously. Restorative proctocolectomy with IPAA, it is either two stage or three stage. Three stage is generally done. Remember, three stage is done in patients. Three stage means, first stage you do subtotal colectomy with end ileostomy, and the distal thing you either three things. Distal part of the colon or rectum, you either bring out as a mucus fistula. You either put it in a subcutaneous plane or you do it as a standard Hartmann. That is, you close the end and stitch it to the parietal wall. Okay, that is how you manage a distal stump. That is first stage of subtotal colectomy with end ileostomy. The second stage is you disrupt the ileostomy, completion proctectomy, completion proctocolectomy. That means you have to remove the remaining colon and rectum, do a IPAA and a diversion ileostomy. The third stage is the ileostomy reversal. Diversion ileostomy is almost a standard after doing any pouch surgery. Okay, especially for ulcerative colitis. For you do even this total proctocolectomy, IPA, even for patients with FAP, familial adenomatous polyposis. In an elective setting, if you're doing surgery for FAP, you may not require a diversion ileostomy because that is a well compensated patient with no previous treatment of steroids and all these things. Nutrition also, they will be good. For them, you can consider for one stage surgery. Or else, as a rule, if you're doing surgery for ulcerative colitis, it has to be at least two stage. In an emergency setting, it has to be three staged. That is mandated. Okay, that is the standard of treatment. Two stage surgery, that means you are doing surgery in an elective setting. Then you can go for first stage total proctocolectomy plus IPAA, diversion ileostomy. The second stage will be ileostomy reversal. So indications, three stage surgeries, all emergency indications which I mentioned above, because all these patients will be managed with IV steroids. Okay. And steroid dependent patient, long term oral steroids, they will be steroids for years and long duration of biological usage. What will happen in these patients? Because the tissues will be fragile, your sutures may cut through, your staple lines may not take up so easily. Tissues are very fragile, so as much as possible you try to avoid anastomosis initially. So in all emergency indication, you do a subtotal colectomy with end ileostomy, you resuscitate the patient, you improve the patient nutritionally, and you make them steroid free. Then you do the pouch with a diversion ileostomy. Even in steroid dependent patient, you remove the entire colon, put a mucus fistula or a Hartmann's procedure, you manage the distal stump with either enemas or suppositories, you make the patient free from steroids for some duration, at least 3 to 6 months. Then you do an ileal pouch anal anastomosis with a diversion ileostomy. Then, and always remember the duration from pouch to ileostomy closure, that is the second and third stage or first and second stage, whatever you are doing, the ileostomy before it has to take at least 2 to 3 months before stoma closure for ulcerative colitis. And before closing the stoma, you have to do a digital rectal examination. You have to look for the stapler line complete, no structure, no growth, your finger is easy passable. You have to do a pouchoscopy, it means you have to do a proctoscopy or a scope, a sigmoidoscopy. You have to look for the entire pouch completion, no leak. You have to do a contrast examination to look for the complete filling of the pouch and no micro leaks. Then only you have to take the patient for stoma closure, or else you can wait. Okay, in two stage, that mostly in elective cases you do a two stage, that is, as I mentioned previously, total proctocolectomy with IPAA, diversion ileostomy. Second stage is the ileostomy closure. Outcomes are morbidity, generally morbidity because of the diversion ileostomy, because more chances of adhesions even after ileostomy closure, more chances of adhesions at the ileostomy closure site also, and also because of small bowel adhesion and pelvic anastomotic leaks and the other things. Pouchitis is expected in about 40 to 50% of patients postoperatively, whether you do a two stage or three stage. More in acute severe colitis managed with steroids, more in patients with PSC. Okay, pouchitis is not seen, very rarely seen in patients whom you do pouch for different indications apart from ulcerative colitis, like patients with FAP. Okay, long-term risk of pouch loss is approximately 5 to 10%. It is usually due to leak causes inflammation, and the leak causes limited pelvic abscess, pelvic sepsis. Because of this, there is extensive fibrotic reaction in and around the pouch, which will cause mechanical pouch failure, because we expect the pouch to distend and have a capacity of up to 300 ml. Because of the pelvic abscess, pelvic sepsis, and the fibrotic reaction and inflammation, The pouch will have a fibrotic reaction and it will shrink. Stricture will form. Pouch loses its function, and that is called as pouch failure, wherein you have to consider for removal of the pouch and do a permanent end ileostomy in such cases. Quality of life, as I said, increase in infertility of women because of the recurrent surgeries and pelvic adhesions. They block the ostia, and 20% of the women will have dyspareunia or fecal incontinence. 4% will have sexual dysfunction in men postoperatively because of the extensive pelvic dissection and nerve injuries. However, most men will have improvement in overall sexual quality of life because the decrease in acute episodes, decrease in the use of steroids and other things. So overall improvement in general health. As I said, this IPA versus gold standard, that is end ileostomy. Generally, quality of life is better in patients with end ileostomy rather than pouch surgery because of the pouch-related complications. Overall quality of life. Okay. Issues with pouch anal anastomosis, ileostomy, ileoanal anastomosis, that is pouch designs of pouch and all these things. Without a diversion ileostomy, how required it is? Yes, it will not prevent the leaks, but it will decrease the complications because of leaks. Okay, so generally, gold standard is to do a diversion ileostomy after pouch anal anastomosis. Here also, you can see with pouch, it is better. The length of stay is less, hospital operative stay. Complication rate, that anastomotic leak, pouch failure is less, and anastomotic stricture is also less in patients with diversion ileostomy. The meta-analysis, which also favors diversion ileostomy, this is the standard J, W, and S pouch. Standard is the J pouch, wherein 15 centimeters, 15 to 20 centimeters length. You do a side-to-side anastomosis of these two limbs, and this edge you do anastomosis with the rectum or anal canal. Okay, so completely this is the pouch. Okay, when do you consider for S pouch or W pouch? Actually, J pouch, to bring this up to the pelvic floor, it is actually a difficult thing. For that, you have to do certain maneuvers, like you have to release the peritoneum mesentery leaflets, anterior and posterior. You have to through the mesentery, okay, preserve the arcade. Just the anterior and posterior layers of the mesentery you have to divide. You can consider dividing the terminal ileocolic artery at its base, preserving this arcade so that this will be supplied from this arcade. Here, if you like it, the length of the ileum coming down will increase, and you have to release the DJ flexure. All these have to be done if your J pouch is not coming freely up to the pelvic bridge. Always remember the standard technique, that is no tension, good vascularity, no disease anastomosis. Okay, always your pouch should come without tension up to the pelvic bridge. For this, approximately we take symphysis pubis. If it is coming freely beyond the symphysis pubis for at least 2 to 3 centimeters overall on the symphysic pubis, if it is coming freely at least 2 to 3 centimeters below the pubic symphysis, then that will surely without tension go. If it is not coming, then you have to do these maneuvers, that is release of the mesentery, ligation of the terminal ileocolic vessel at its base, dividing the mesentery transversely over the SMA and its branches, and release of the DJ flexure. Okay, these maneuvers can be done to make. If even after doing all this, if it is not coming down, the J pouch is not coming down freely, then you have to consider turning it into S pouch. That means now this additional length you will get conversion of J to S pouch. Okay, now this is very important because it has to be without tension. Once if it is under tension, then decreased vascularity, more chances of anastomotic disruption, leak, pelvic sepsis. Okay, and future stricture formation, pouch failure. Your entire pouch will fail in future. So there is no point in trying to pull it and do a tension under anastomosis. Okay, you should never compromise with any anastomosis whatsoever. It always has to be no tension, good vascularity, no active disease, less inflammatory area. Okay, not only this, any anastomosis with no distal obstruction. Okay, these are the modifications. Generally, what we consider is W pouch is more bulky, so you will have better control. Okay, but overall pouch related complications are actually similar. There are studies which show similarities. Long term results are similar with J and W pouch. Complications with W pouch, because you are doing multiple anastomoses. So any one minor leak also leads to loss of pouch. You have to remember the complications of pouch surgery: immediate post-op complication, that is bleeding, anastomotic leak, intramural abscess, pelvic sepsis, systemic sepsis, small bowel obstruction, maybe adhesive, and anastomotic disruption, also pouchitis. Late complications, again pouchitis, stricture formation, pouch dysfunction, small bowel obstruction. You just have to remember these complications. Of these complications, few are very important, because I'll tell you, you need not go into all these are self-explanatory complications except pouchitis, because that has a pouchitis and pouch dysfunction are a completely different subset. Okay, pouchitis, stricture, late complications, pouchitis, stricture formation, pouch dysfunction, small bowel obstruction, pouch failure, pouch dysplasia, and fertility and incontinence. One technical point of view is the rectal dissection. You need always in the background of malignancy, you have to treat in terms of malignancy, that is oncological margins and all these things. If it is rectal malignancy, again this oncological principles of CA rectum come into play, wherein you can consider for neoadjuvant chemo radiation, you have to go in the prescribed TME plane. If there is no underlying malignancy, the dissection will be close to the rectum to prevent any neurological damages and further complications. So if malignancy is developing in the background of ulcerative colitis, either any level, whether it be a colonic malignancy or CA rectum, you have to treat in terms of the oncological principles. The oncological principles hold good even in the background of ulcerative colitis. Okay, even if you're resecting, you have to resect it up to the base, ligate the vessels at the base and all these things. Okay. Regarding pouchitis, you have to remember one thing, that pouchitis 40% incidence in the first 10 years, and again it increases to by the next 10 to 20 years. The pouchitis rate increases. It can be acute pouchitis or chronic pouchitis. It can be antibiotically able to treat pouchitis or antibiotic resistant pouchitis. The basic etiology of pouchitis, most important it is idiopathic, and any ulcerative colitis with underlying PSC, more risk of pouchitis. It can be ischemic, because the vascular pattern is changing. More importantly, because the organisms are changing. Normally you will have rectum and rectal or microbiota, which are completely different from small bowel microbiota. Now small bowel microbiota is there just above the anal canal and rectum. So because of the change in microbiota also, it is one of the most important indication, most important etiology for pouchitis. Okay, so pouchitis normally for diagnosis, you know, they come with the frequency, mild occasional bleed, pain, tenesmus, urgency, all these things. Upon endoscopy, the stapler line is intact, but the pouch shows features of inflammation. Biopsy is mandatory. There is something called as pouchitis disease activity index, and depending on that, you have to start the treatment. Most important line of treatment is antibiotics, because there is change in microbiota. Okay, first you will give bowel specific antibiotics. If it is not responding, you will add two antibiotics. If it is not responding, then you will have to add probiotics. Okay, this is the standard of management. Very, very rarely you may have to use immunobiologic, that is like azathioprine, infliximab, all these things for even pouchitis. If it is not responding even to that, then you have to consider for pouch. You have to label it as pouch dysfunction, and you have to remove the pouch and consider for an endileostomy. Okay. Generally, the pouchitis is also antibiotic responsive, antibiotic resistant. Okay. I think I've covered the maximum of surgery in acute ulcerative colitis. Anything, any doubts, you can actually message me so that I'll clear your doubts.
Sir? Sir? Sir, Rajshekhar speaking,
Yeah.
sir. Sir, thank you very much, sir. This was a very elaborate lecture.
Yeah,
It was very informative.
yes,
We
to
have only.
diagnose pouch, I'm seeing it. There is one doubt from Aditya. For diagnosis of
Yes, sir.
pouchitis, you need to evaluate clinically. You need to see it. Because you have to see the rectal mucosa remnant. You have to see the anastomotic site. You have to go into the pouch. You have to see the pouch changes. Those will be similar. Edema, mucosal edema, loss of vascular pattern and nodularity. You have to take the biopsy. You have to document the inflammation. Then only you can label it as pouchitis. Okay. Risk of cancer is more in ulcerative colitis compared to Crohn's. Even in Crohn's, the risk of malignancy is there, but it is comparatively less compared to ulcerative colitis. In both are pre-malignant. Few textbooks say Crohn's no pre-malignant, no chances of turning this into malignancy. Both are pre-malignant. Chances of turning into malignancy with ulcerative colitis is more, and more with associated PSC and pancolitis, and more number of acute severe episodes. Other modalities for small bowel imaging. See, for modalities for imaging, you can consider for CT enterocolitis, but you need to have radiation exposure and all these things, contrast induced complication and all these things. Because most of IBD patients are young patients and they require frequent imaging, frequent follow-up. So, MR enterography is equally good for small bowel imaging. If not sufficient length of small bowel is available for pouch and anal anastomosis, that is what I said. Your first preference is always J pouch. If J is not coming, in spite of all these manures, you can consider trying it into a S pouch. If it is still not coming, do not hesitate to do an endoileostomy. Always, always explain the patient that there is always a minor chance for an endoileostomy if the pouch is not coming down. Because once the pouch is gone, the complications are high, the morbidity is high, the patient's quality of life will exclusively come down like anything. Timing of ileostomy reversal, as I told you, it is at least 2 to 3 months. And before doing ileostomy reversal, I told you it is mandatory to do a per-rectal digital examination, scope, okay, and also a contrast study to look for any minor leaks to diagnose pouchitis. I think I've cleared most of your doubts, whatever are there. If there are any doubts, you can just message me anytime in WhatsApp. I'll try to clear your double balloon endoscopy role in small bowel imaging. See, as I told you, double balloon endoscopy, enteroscopy, actually it is not, I mean, it is better labeled as enteroscopy because it goes into the small intestine. Okay, you can go, but the imaging only you will get and approximate length, but you will not have a diagnostic. That is, I mean, you cannot take biopsies much from it. Very limited role for biopsies. Approximate length of bowel you will not know. Okay, so double balloon endoscopy can be done, but there are limited. It's limited. It is not available in all the centers. Okay, endoscopy it can maximum go up to proximal 50 to 100 centimeters, maximum 150 centimeters. Beyond that, again, you know, it all depends on technical this thing. I mean, it all depends on the gastroenterologist who is doing it. If he's really capable, very good equipment and all these things, probably he can go up to 150 to max. Apart from that, I don't think it's a major role. You cannot even take proper biopsies and all these things.
So if everyone is done with their questions, you can send them to search member. Sir, thank you very much for sparing time
Yeah.
on this day, sir, and preparing this presentation for the sake of us.
I hope I mean considered most of the topics for general surgery point of view. My idea of giving you lectures is that after if you get any patient like bile duct injury or ulcerative colitis, you will at least you need to have the basic knowledge of how to deal with them, when to refer them, what surgery to be done. Because as I said, emergency, why not to do a proctectomy in emergency surgery? You will damage the planes of the rectum. So in emergency setting, you do not go into the rectal dissection or pelvic dissection. You preserve the rectum and the pelvic planes. In the second stage, you will go into the pelvic planes, neatly dissect it, then do an pouch. So from your general surgery, if you are doing, you have to have the idea that no, it has to be a two-stage surgery, a three-stage surgery. You have to do a subtotal colectomy. You should not touch the pelvis. You should not touch the rectum because that will damage the planes and future IPA will be very, 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 very difficult. Okay. And once if it is difficult, it means the quality of life will eventually come down. So you should have a basic idea of how to deal with all these cases. Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much. And I'll
Thank
look
you, sir.
forward for the next class. I'll update you soon. Sorry for the delay in this. I had few cases and emergency cases, so I had to attend them. Okay. Thank you very much. I'll update
Thank
regarding
you.
the next class in our meeting. Thank you.